Just watching DC fandom just now, I was a wee bit scared at start because I couldn't get it to work on my TV. It's dark just now because I'm not using it, I'm using my computer to watch it. I can't make it work on my TV, so I'm sorry about the brightness of you can't see the face. There we go. What do you think of DC fandom so far? It's been brilliant, what I've seen. Honestly, at one point I paused it and I honestly thought like I'd missed the Zack Snyder bit. Stupidly enough, I didn't actually check the schedule, so I thought it was gut wrenching. But when I started watching it, I just fell in love with the DC. I was watching it with my boy. And we saw the trailer for Wonder Woman. Fantastic. I think they've done a wonderful job with Cheetah. She looks great in the role. This, any doubt about the actress playing her washed away. The story looks brilliant, memorizing and stuff like that. Yeah, and I loved the lead up to the trailer. I loved all the fans getting on board and the cosplay and everything else. It really has been a real good treat for the fans. And then you get wee little bits in between with the sort of DC animation things with the children's voices and stuff like that. I thought that was cute and funny. And the wee inside about the comics and the multiverse and stuff and how that's playing a key role. And you had the top men like Walter Hamada, Jim Lee and stuff like Greg Berlanti, who does the TV shows. What made me a wee bit worried was when they were talking about the multiverse, they mentioned how Flash and Wonder Woman and Aquaman's in one universe, but they didn't mention like Batman or Superman. So it's made me worried about these two characters because, but again, this is hopefully what Zack Snyder's going to reveal. And I'm actually interested now in the Sandman. I loved the documentary on the Sandman, coming to Netflix, I'm definitely up for it. The game, I'm not excited about the game, to be honest. It's the Bat family and everything else, but it's not something new. I didn't see all of the game, but footage, because I had to go and sort something out, and that's when I paused it and I thought I missed the Zack Snyder. But what I think really surprised me the most was the Suicide Squad. I was apprehensive about the film. I think my boy was too. About what's it about, the characters being used. A lot of the characters I hadn't heard before. So it's going to be great. And what I saw of the backstage to the Suicide Squad is actually given me hope for the movie. I mean, Polka Dot Man, throwing polka dots in it. But I've often said that there's a lot of TV series out there that, I know what it was, Supernatural, where they would take some daft idea, and although it doesn't seem sinister at first, by the time you get close to the middle or the end of the episode of Supernatural, you know, you could be scared of Santa Claus. That's how it can turn on, you know. So Polka Dot Man might be a right vicious sword. Weasel? Wow. Where did Weasel come from? I mean, I seen a wee second clip of the Weasel behind the door and I thought, wow. What scares me the most, but is it... if it's going to fall into Guardians of the Galaxy, which, surprisingly to a lot of people, I'm not a big fan of. They're okay movies, but I don't get excited with Groot or anything like that. And I noticed a couple of actors that he used in Guardians of the Galaxy, James Fillion, and I can't remember the guy's name, but he played the blue alien or whatnot. I think he was also in the Walking Dead. So he's playing actors that he knows. So I just hope it has a different tone to Guardians of the Galaxy and it's more serious. But how he presented the whole thing, James Gunn, it actually made me warm to the guy. You know, so there is hope for it. Margot Robbie was surprisingly quiet for it. She never really said much, and I like to see the familiar faces about it. What else did I like? This is something I honestly believe this should happen every year, DC fandom. On the internet, you know, because it's more. I'm not just saying maybe exclusive for DC, but for any sort of fandom, for any thing like Marvel or stuff like that, there should be things like this on a day to day basis, and it'll make you love it. The presenters were great. They really made sure that, you know, it's all over the world. You know, I mean, right now there's a Batman thing on about subtitling over the stuff. And it's, they're really trying to push this thing that is okay to like different versions of the superhero character. You know, and at last, Walter Amadu and stuff like that and has woken up to the idea that you can make TV shows and not, you know, you can have like 5 Batman TV shows and have Batman on the big screen as well. People are going to be able to differentiate them all. Hence why we got Arrow instead of a Batman TV series. So I'm hoping this is turning the tide. I'm still worried over the title of Zack Snyder's Justice League. I'm still wearing this today. This will be the last day of wearing this. Zack Snyder. Or I might just wear it as, I don't know, as a something. But I'm also a bit wary of Ben Affleck. Right. Oh, it may be just starting just now. I'll turn up. Oh God, I'm turning the wrong volume up.
Wasn't bad. Why the late Ben Audio mixing the song luck? Maybe they'll cast me as the Italian Robert Pattinson in the next film. What do you think? Coming up, we have another WB Games debut, and we are talking to Matt Reeves, director of The Batman.
Fans, since 2017 you have been demanding the release of Zack Snyder's version of Justice League, of course. Your friends at HBO Max heard you and looked for it in 2021.
I know. That probably feels like a long way off. So, right now, we're going to check out
so
this.
So, get on your internet. Well, by the time this is loaded, it's already done. So, here we go.
As well as some of the fans who helped bring this DC dream come to life.
Oh. Zack Snyder
awesome.
Behind
awesome.
All the scenes.
Guys, it's awesome to be here at DC Fandom. This is amazing. It's been a quiet journey with the DC fans, and I've had a great time bringing some of these beloved DC titles to the big screen. And the Justice League really is, for me, and in this format, an amazing crown jewel. As a community, we're able to make this thing happen. We really appreciate it. We're going to shake it up a little bit for this panel, and I'm going to have some fans ask me questions. I'm going to ask some people questions. We've got a special guest, so let's get to it. We have some questions from fans read to us by some of the amazing cast of Justice League. Looks like next we have Batman, my Batman. Go ahead, Ben, what do you got?
I hope you guys are enjoying DC Fandom. And I'm really excited for you to get a chance to see Zack's ultimate version of Justice League on HBO Max next year.
Well, thank you, Ben. I'm excited for everyone to see the film as well. It's cool. What question do you have?
Patrick Mendoza wants to know, who is your favorite superhero of all time? You know the answer to that, but go ahead and answer it.
I guess my favorite hero of all time, other than Batman, would have to be sort of staying in the DC world as I do. It's got to be Dr. Manhattan from Watchmen, I think. I don't know, for me, he's like this super cool quantum superhero whose time, space, reality, all those things are at his fingertips. So, yeah, it's got to be Dr. Manhattan. That was awesome, Ben. Thank you so much. That was cool, and appreciate you stopping by. I think next, is it Superman?
Hello, everybody. My name is Henry Cavill, and I promise you that I'm not in prison. This is just my place of work. I hope you're enjoying DC Fandom, and I have a fan question for Zack Snyder from Swapnil. As a storyteller, what is the dynamic between the Justice League that is important for you to present on the screen? Zack, over to you.
It's a great question, and thank you so much. I think the important thing for me as the Justice League comes together is this idea that, like, a lot of them basically are loners, right? You got Batman, who's in a cave. His only buddy is Alfred, really. You got Wonder Woman, who, after Steve's demise, she's been kind of keeping quiet. You have Flash, he's got these powers. He's kind of alone in the world. And you have Cyborg, who, you know, in a lot of ways, is not really happy about what's happened to him. This transformation, he's coming to terms with it. And then you have Aquaman, who also is this loner. And sort of thematically, them coming together and forming a family and finding in each other support, I think that's really what, in the end, drove me to want to see this happen or see them come together. And I think that when you take all these different personalities and bring them together into a single cohesive group, it's a fun and awesome dynamic, but also there's a why of doing it. All right, let's see, who do we have next? Is it Cyborg?
Hey, Zack, what up, man? Ray Fisher here. You know I am super excited about the Snyder Cut getting dropped on HBO Max, and there's some folks who have a couple questions for you. The first question is coming from Eddie Gordon from the United States, and that question is, which character are you most excited to fully flesh out in your cut of Justice League?
Interesting that you should ask me that. Because, of course, it's Cyborg. Cyborg is the heart of the movie. Cyborg is the thing that I think, in the end, holds the team together in a lot of ways. And excited to see, or for fans to see, just how that is realized on cameras.
And the second question is coming in from Irfan Kam from the United Kingdom. And their question is, when you started writing Justice League, what thematic ideas were you most excited to tackle? Additionally, how much of a challenge was it to keep the tone mythological? I want to know too, so make sure you get up on those.
It's a great question. When Chris and I were talking about this movie, I think we're big fans of sort of the Joseph Campbellian, you know, hero's journey, and also this notion that we would be creating a team. It's the Knights of the Round Table joining together in an epic adventure, and this is the call to action film that brings them as a story, that brings them all together. And I think it is a mythological concept to begin with, so keeping it mythological, and especially when you think about it, it's Aquaman, it's Wonder Woman, Flash, Cyborg, and then Superman, you're really talking about a mythological group, you know. Okay, this is fun. Let's keep them coming. Who else? I think next is the Flash himself.
Mr. Maestro Zack Snyder, I mean, what other questions can we ask? I think we'd all like to know if we'll see more of the handsome and talented Ezra Miller in your cut.
I like the question, Ezra. No agenda at all. Very good. Of course, you're going to see tons more of the Flash. I have a huge love for The Flash and for Ezra Miller, as you know, especially when you call me at the last second and make me come work on music videos in the desert. That's really kind of you. So, but yes, of course, Ezra, I think people are going to see a lot more of The Flash, and they're going to get to see a little bit more of his emotional arc, and I hope they enjoy it, because I enjoy it. Seeing you, especially in this format. Okay, looks like we've got we've got something from Wonder Woman herself, Gal Gadot.
Zach, when you cast me in the role of Wonder Woman, I had no idea what an amazing ride I was in for. It's been life-changing to play this character, mostly because I've got to meet so many incredible fans around the world who love her like we do. Fans who I hope are all sharing this experience today, because it's all happening because of you. So to all the fans who asked for this cut, you obviously have your own superpowers because you made this possible. So thank you. I love you.
Thanks, Gal. I can't wait for fans to see you in Wonder Woman 84, which is an amazing movie, and you are amazing in it. And Patty, of course, did an amazing job. So you guys are an awesome team, and
you produced that.
Blown when they see that. So thanks again. That was great. All right, let's see. Who do we have next?
Hi, Zach, and everybody in the Justice League crew. I have a question. So, as somebody who is so very excited to get to see your vision of Justice League, and that you're finally getting this chance to really show us the film that was always intended and one that we're all so super excited to see, I wanted to know, probably what everybody wants to know is, can you hint something that the world has never seen, that you have been so excited to let us all get a glimpse at without too many spoilers?
Okay, how do I do this without giving too many spoilers? You're gonna see something with Flash in this film I don't think that you've ever seen before. Something that has to do with his abilities, because you know he's a quantum character. He interacts with time and space, so you might see him do something that is timely. But awesome, Patty, awesome question, and it's awesome to see you. All right, let's move along, shall we? And I think I want to ask some questions. So let's get some people on the line if we can. I'd like to get, there's some super fans we have standing by, I see. One of them is Fiona from China. She is dear to our hearts. She was one of the founding members of the Snyder Cut movement and really instrumental in bringing it to all of us. So let's get her on the line and say hi to her.
Oh my God, Zach and his studio, it's like a dream come true.
I'm going to ask you some questions. Are you ready?
Okay, I'm ready.
First off, was What about this movement and the Snyder Cut and the whole thing? What was the thing that got you to say, like, hey, you know what? I gotta, like, get involved with this?
After I saw Batman with Superman in theaters 4 years ago in China, I was blown away. After watching Justice League, it was immediately clear that many parts of the film were not consistent with your usual filmmaking style. So we are the fans. We knew that there was a real version of the film out there. We started asking for it. Why not? We started a petition, if you remember, that reached to 180,000 people signed. Then I think it's not enough. I created a website called FirstSnyderCut.com that allowed us to start doing some online and real-world events, such as Twitter trends, raising money for AFSP, letter writing, and phone calls to Warner Brothers. Now, here we are.
Awesome. Wow. And look what happened. You guys did it. It's unbelievable.
Yeah, I can't believe it.
So did you really think it was going to happen, though, when it got closer?
It all started with hope and dream. So many movements, I think, never go beyond that. To actually achieve a dream, you need organization and selflessness. Then we have a team that could put a billboard in Times Square.
Yeah, it's amazing.
I think you remember that.
Fantastic.
When you see all these people, when you fight alongside such talent and generous people, you know it's not possible. It's a certainty.
Yeah.
Even we had many obstacles, but we know we will win this.
Yeah, it's funny. I always thought it was funny that, like, the scale started to get bigger and bigger, and we would notice, like, oh my gosh.
What
first,
is
remember,
the
just
title
was, like,
of
a bus
the movie?
In Comic-Con, and then a billboard in Times Square, and then on the anniversary of Justice League, and it just goes completely nuts, and everyone's like, okay.
It's like snowball, rolling with a big snowball.
Yeah, a giant snowball now, yeah. What was your favorite moment for you in the whole experience?
I think my answer to this question evolved. I started out because I admire you. I love you. I want to fight for you and your works. But as time passed, I became just much about fighting alongside my fellow community members. It's power from art, mostly. Power from you, art. You empowered us.
Well, that's amazing and kind. And it's amazing to see you. And thank you so much for connecting with us. I can't wait to come to China.
Please come to China. I want to be your guide. So see you?
Yep, see you soon. Thank you, Fiona. Okay, we have another call from Dexter, another amazing friend and another amazing fan who also was super important in the creation and cultivation of this movement. He's been around for a long time and really making this happen. So let's talk to Dexter. Mm-hmm. Dexter.
Hi, how are you, my friend?
Awesome, I'm glad you came. It's great to see you.
Thank you, great to see you as well.
So I got you on the spot because I want to ask you a couple questions. So I guess the first question is, you know, what are your initial thoughts and where were you when you first heard about the Snyder Cut movement or how did it come on your radar?
Yeah, well, it was very early on, I'll tell you, right after the viewing of the theatrical edition, I went to the internet and I felt that I couldn't be the only one that felt a certain way. So after maybe a few weekends, I had a few chats with a few people, and it kind of fell into my lap, and I said, this is something that I can really get behind, and I did what I could in order to try to help, and here I am, you know, multiple years later, still trying to be a forefront of this whole thing to help you guys out, and thankfully, it's been a positive turn of events.
Yeah, like, how crazy is it that, like, I was saying the other day, I shot the movie in 2016. Like, that's when I was on set shooting. And here we are in 2021, and, well, coming up to, and that's when the movie's going to come out. And seems impossible.
Yeah, that's awesome.
So, to that, when you started this movement, did you think there was a chance that they would do this?
That's a really great question. Early on, I had high hopes about it, and I think it was just because of my ignorance on how the industry worked. Toward, you know, a quarter into it, I kind of said, well, we're not really speaking their language. How can we get them to want to do this for us? I think that's the key, and Rich, what made it really happen is just the fact that they saw that there were so many people that really wanted to stand behind the artistry of it all, the artists and the integrity of it. And here we are.
I always felt like when I was sort of observing this movement, in a lot of ways, for fans, the way the comic book calendar is set up, you know, it'd be like, oh, the anniversary of the release, or a Comic-Con, or a Brazil Comic-Con, or New York Comic-Con, and you guys just always kind of using those events as like a springboard, because you're like, look, we got something to say, so it always felt like.
Yeah, it was tough coming up with those things at times, really. We would chatter a lot of behind-the-scenes Zoom calls and phone calls and WhatsApp messages, really trying to come up with what can we do next? What are we thinking about our next event? And then when you were to kind of give us a little hint or a little something to play along with, and it just really, really ignited us to continue on. So thank you for that.
Yeah, that for me was amazing. It was cool to have this kind of conversation with the fans where I could, like, either, you know, release an image or just say something and just get this response that I could feel, this kind of energy exchange that was really, really, really exciting. Do you have a favorite moment from this experience?
I think my favorite moment so far is getting the opportunity to fly out to your event in Pasadena. The Director's Cut weekend was such a memorable event for me and my sons, and something I will always cherish with me. One of the other things I was just really, really excited to see, and this is just me and I don't want to make things heavy, but just the opportunity to see the smile on yours and Debbie's face when it was official. It was just really heartwarming to me, and honestly, I did tear up a little bit. I will admit, I teared up a little bit, but it's just because it was just a lot of work that paid off, and I'm just excited to see that you guys were really, really happy.
Well, I got to admit that we also, you know, when we heard the news, we all got pretty emotional, and it's been an incredible journey. And for us, one of the amazing parts is that we were able to, you know, interact with and be part of this fan community in an amazing way, and it's changed us and made us, you know, really grateful for being able to have this dialogue and also frankly feeling the incredible support for the work that I get to experience, you know, when we see these fan generated events and things that really have nothing to do with selling a movie or doing anything that has to do with commerce. It's really for love, and we feel it. And also the amazing charitable work that you guys, the amount of money you've raised for suicide prevention is just unbelievable. So again, thank you so much. We couldn't thank you enough. So Dexter, thanks.
Thank you so much. It's been our pleasure. We appreciate it.
It's cool to interact with the fans and get to talk about this this journey that we've been on, because it has been something quite amazing. Maybe I should talk for a second about how you guys are going to see the movie and what format we're going to have it in. It's going to be in four parts, 1 hour each. So 4 hours of Justice League is coming your way. We're going to work on a way of bundling it together at the end so you can watch it as a single film, if that's the way you want to experience it. Also, to all my international fans and everyone watching all over the world, don't worry if you don't have HBO Max, because we're working on a distribution plan. So
yes!
I promise you, you're going to get a chance to see
yes.
it. Yes! Guys,
it's bringing tears to my eyes right now.
People, you can get your associate producer shirt.
Thank to the people. Buy your sweatshirts,
t-shirts,
grab
a shirt.
Associate producer.
I guess it's time to play the little teaser, because that's why you're really here. See some footage from the movie, as I promised. So,
I'm just going to follow me, because I'm sure it's going to be on YouTube.
Check that out. So, here it is. Justice League.
Max original. What the? Justice League Tower? She sees the arrow on the ground. Irish Allen. Oh, the best shot that was never in the movie in Batman. See, okay, right, you can list off things that I've missed, okay? Okay, we've seen the scene of Batman standing on top of the building looking down on the gargoyle, you know the picture. We've seen Cyborg limping that you saw in the wee teaser trailer. The truth to the trailer, well, was a wee bit saddening and everything else. You see Superman punched Steppenwolf wearing the black suit. You've seen Flash somehow time travel to some sort of place. You saw the Justice League building in ruins. The Justice League. I never saw that coming. Okay, you get what was it called? I need to watch this. Do I wear this? Is it called the Zack Snyder's Justice League? I don't know. I need to watch it again. I need to watch this again. But no, four parts and 1 hour episodes, and then it's going to be, it's going to make it into a movie. And then he says, don't worry, it's going to turn it down a wee bit. Don't worry, we're going to get it. Those people that don't have HBO Max, we are going to make some sort of an arrangement. The trailer, okay, I must admit, when I seen Darkseid at the start, I was like, that's not real. That's some sort of game. I wasn't too convinced. I'll need to go back and watch it again because it was like, Darkseid. This was the first close-up image of Darkseid. Then, of course, you've seen Steppenwolf, like we've seen. There's little wee tiny moments of like Aquaman dropping the fork as like drop the mic and whatnot, and He walks back in the bubble. I can't remember if I've seen that, but that somehow, it just seemed a wee bit more significant. He just walks away from Mera, which of course wasn't in the Justice League, but I don't know. There was a lot to take in. What else was there? Oh yeah, the Flash saving Iris from the car.
Cyborg's dad dying.
Cyborg's dad dying, okay? He wasn't killed by a parademon that you sort of tried to think was in the original trailer, where you've seen the parademon's eyes, then you see him getting worried. No, it seems to be he takes it from a laser for some reason. Or maybe was he getting turned into a parademon because his face was starting to change or something. So maybe he was... He was next to the mother box. Yeah, see, I'm not taking all this in. I was too busy crying. See, some of the fans that came on board and said how much they expressed themselves and how much it meant to Zach. Oh, do you know the one thing, you know, the things I didn't hear? I didn't hear if we're going to get any more after this. You know, we didn't hear if we're going to get a Zack Snyder's Justice League Part 2. You know, we didn't... I hope we do, of course. four parts, 1 hour, 4 hours long. I mean, there's got to be a lot more. I don't think the trailer spoiled too much. It was just trying to emphasise how different it was. And when Bruce Wayne says, you know, they never have defeated us, you know, they won't defeat us united and stuff. It just, that stuff in the back of the sweatshirt of, that you got from Zack Snyder just means ton more. Did we see any Green Lantern? Nope. Did we see any sort of Green Martian? Nope. But we did see a different scene with Martha and Lois coming together and cuddling and everything else. And also, you saw the scene when they're in the field and the two of them are hugging. For some strange reason, that was taken out of the original. And you just saw the car pulling up. And it was his mum. And that was it. For some strange reason, that was cut. So,
Superman's
Yeah, we've seen Superman's, of course, the black suit coming out of the cave and stuff like that. What else? No, I mean, there were bits of course, this Flash running and experimenting and stuff like that. We've seen Cyborg with the missiles. We've seen, I don't know, there was just something, what else? Wonder Woman. That you've seen just Wonder Woman actually going to where the arrow landed, and I don't know, there's going to be something more about every character. Now, you remember, this film, when it first came out, Justice League was only 2 hours long. 2 hours. We're getting double that. So that's only showing a minuscule of it. And that was, for me, that panel was just a thank you to everyone involved. To everyone, to all the fans that just never gave up, on this, and as I say, I'll be wearing this until I get some confirmation on the title. Okay, I've already made a video that will appear somewhere down the line with me not wearing it, but I think it will be a normal thing for me anyway after that. So. You got anything else you liked about the trailer? No?
No.
I did see some fight sequences with Batman. Oh, well, it just came back to me. There's a scene there where the parademons are like shooting at Batman and he's just like got his hand up like that, taking the blast. I went, yes. And of course, we're going to get that scene where he goes, now it's my turn. That is going to go. And what did happen to the wall crawler that got stuck halfway up the well, you know, the well? You know, it didn't seem to suddenly get back on top. So, yeah, it's and of course, Zack Snyder says it's going to be a wee bit bloodier. Then, of course, we have a different fight sequence at the when Superman comes back because you see Cyborg crashing into that car, you know, blocking it from that police officer that's probably the original scene for Jimmy. So let me know what you thought about it. Let me know what you thought about the whole DC fandom thing. Was it worth you while staying up watching it? But for us, it was like that appeared at 10:30 at night. So it was well worth the wait. And again, I stress it.
It's 11 o'clock.
So it's, yeah, I mean, everything in the show, Suicide Squad, Wonder Woman, they did an excellent job of getting us excited for everything DC. And of course, later on after this, there's the other game coming out, I believe. So let us know, and I'll catch you again.